if you could go back and relive one day of your life all over again and unmake the mistake that left you a million miles away from the you you once knew. Now yesterday's shame keeps saying that you'll never get back on track. But what if I told you you one step away from surrender? Whole earthquake that love's display.
3 days silent in the ground. His body bore for heaven's
Peter chapter 2. And for it is God's will that you silence the ignorance of foolish people by doing good. As God's slaves, live as free people, but don't use your freedom as a way to conceal evil. We do have a few announcements this week. We'll be resuming Bible study at 4:30 this afternoon after a brief recap. Thanksgiving dinner at 4 p.m. next Sunday in the Mac building. We need to set a date for putting up the Christmas decorations. And what does everybody else would like to do? We're making plans for our regular Christmas program at the Sunshine Inn. Those who would like to donate time or gifts, please see Miss Sarah. Advent devotionals will soon be available. Thank you to everyone who contributed. I hope we'll be able to publish another volume of writings very soon. And get ready for our youth Christmas musical coming soon to a church near you. We'll post a date and time as soon as we can. Are there any other announcements that I might overlook?
We have a 4:30 meeting on fruit baskets for our Christmas presents. invited me to come to that meeting, Sovereign.
All right. Let's see. We do have two birthdays this week. Ronnie Mills. See him when you know if y'all that's tomorrow if y'all see him around I wish him a happy birthday and brother Eugene
Hey what's going on with that
this is a little gift from the church to you
is this from you
no
is this from you
church.
The church
Well,
thank you church thank you
And,
what? Older than I was last year. Hey, come on. Come on. Wow. Who's the wow before that, man? What is thank you. Thank you. This week, and it's Joanne and Jim Kennedy's. Woo-hoo. It's Tuesday. Woo-hoo. Congratulations. And 2 years. And we'll sing happy anniversary to them. Praises this week?
Yeah, Matthew Smith came home from the Army Thursday night.
Good. Thank you.
Mama and Jamie have an anniversary this week, too.
It's not on. It's not on?
I didn't know.
What day?
It's the same day as each birthday.
Thank you very much. I would have put it if I had known. Thank you very much. We would.
A happy anniversary?
Yes, it is.
What was anyone we could add to our prayer list this week? Anybody we can remove? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for allowing us to be here this Sunday morning. Look over the ones that were mentioned this morning on our prayer list and keep us all in your thoughts and your prayers. And we'll say the prayer that you all taught us. Yeah. Our Father, your heart in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Morning.
Let's all stand and turn to page one. Okay, if you'll turn to page 227. And we'll sing all those verses. It's a short song. Has a lot of meaning. Rock of ages, cleft for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Let the water rest.
turn to page 215. This is certainly a song we need to stand up on.
Thank you. today. You know, last week I talked to you about this is a month of Thanksgiving, and we're going to have gratitudes in our heart being thankful. Well, I want to tell you a story I read in the Bible. Jesus told, there were 10 leopards, and this is people that had sickness, sores on them. And when you got that, they did not let you go into town. They did not let you be with your people, your family, because it was very contagious. Well, they heard that Jesus was in the area, and they went to ask him if he would cure them. And he did. And he says, now you go and show the priest, because the priest had okayed them to go back to their homes. Well, he did. And as they were walking, their sores began to heal. One turned around and went back and thanked Jesus. Out of 10, only one said thank you. When you do something for someone, doesn't it make you feel good for them to tell you, thank you for doing that for me? At this Thanksgiving season, let's have a thankful heart and think about all what God has done for us each and every day. You be the one that turns back and you say thank you, because you've got so much to be thankful for. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, let our hearts grow with thanksgiving, and let us return it to others when they do things for us. Amen. Good job. Good job. I've got a little fun activity. It's a turkey. And you are, when you get home or in the Sunday school, you cut out his parts. And on each feather, you write something you're thankful for. And then you glue it on that sheet of paper and color. Okay? So each one of you can do this at home, or you can, in your Sunday school, Miss Barbara will let you do it, I'm sure. Okay? Good job.
I got my
soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here will be forever mine. Will be forever.
Open your hearts. We are going to wind up here in Romans 8, but we're not going to start there. I'd like you to look in Matthew chapter 5 to begin with, and we will move from there. This is probably the second part. I don't usually do series, but the second part of a message that started last week. And I was just absolutely delighted when we had our meeting Sunday afternoon and the district superintendent asked everybody in attendance, he said, do you remember what your preacher preached on this morning? And I don't know if he was trying to figure out if I do my job well or not. I don't know what, but almost everybody there could say, yeah, we talked about attitude. And we did. The title was Attitude, Only You Can Change It. I said that last week. I would say it again this week, and I hold to it. Attitude only, it says that God sets before us life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life. You got that? I've set before you today. Life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life. And so attitude, there is only one person that can change it. But I could hear some people this week saying, well, does that mean that we can just sort of save ourselves? Does that mean we can just sort of maybe change a little of our attitude? Although I do think a little good attitude will go a long way. And it just occurred to me that maybe we need to flesh out just a little bit more what we mean last week about attitude and this week about happiness, which is what we're talking about, happiness, how to have a happy life. And the plain truth is that everybody that showed up here at church today, the person sitting to your left, and if you have someone sitting to your right, or the person near you, and the person that you are, all want to find happiness. And matter of fact, you could probably say that more than anything else, this is the struggle of life, to find happiness. And we got all kinds of tricks that we as human beings try in order to make ourselves happy. If I just get enough money in the bank, maybe I'll be happy. And then we get enough money in the bank and we figure out that money does not make you happy. It may be a little bit easier when you have money in the bank to pay what it is that you need to pay. And all God's children said amen, but you can have a bunch of money in the bank and you can still be a miserable wretch. Or we say, well, maybe if I just find the right person, maybe if I just find the right person, then I'll be happy. Lo and behold, to find out that I may find the right person, but if I'm still wrong myself, then no matter how right that person is, it's still going to go south. I love the story about the husband and the wife. And I can't remember if I told it last week. I think I did, but I can't remember. Where they asked the preacher's wife if he made her happy. And she said, no, and he never has made me happy. To which he said to his wife very loudly, you need to explain to these people right now what it is that you're saying, because that doesn't sound very good. And she said, for the first 6 months of our marriage, I expected myself to get happy. Every single time I expected to get happy, every day after he came home from work. And I realized very quickly that he would never make me happy. That there was only one person that could make me happy, and it's myself. So enough money, the right relationship, maybe changing jobs. That's not to say that you shouldn't change jobs from time to time. Some of us stay in a job that we probably should have quit 2 or 3 years ago. Don't take that the wrong way. Someone come and say, preacher, you telling me to quit my job? No, I'm not telling you to quit your job. But I'm saying sometimes we stay in a situation that we don't need to stay in when God is trying to lead us somewhere else. And but all of these different things and many other things will say, well, if I just find this, or if I just meet this person, or if I just get that or the other, then I'm going to be happy. And we just unfortunately have to find out time after time after time that all of these things that we tell ourselves. You can win the girl. You can win the presidential election. and still be a miserable wretch. I'm going to tell you right now, you can get exactly what it is that you think that it is that you want, and at the end of the day, still be as miserable as you were before you didn't have everything that you thought you wanted. And so how to have a happy life, what does it mean to have a happy life? It occurred to me, Kevin, after we got the verses for this week, that it might be helpful to see what Jesus had to say about happy. And if you look in Matthew 5, verse 3, here's a little thing that Jesus had to say about being happy. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, not the weak. Blessed are the meek. Doesn't say weak. Blessed are the meek. Someone said meekness is strength under control. Strength under control. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. So to be filled, you got to be hungry. And if you ain't spiritually hungry, you can come to church, but if you're not spiritually hungry, you'll still go away hungry. If you come to church wanting to get something instead of to get somebody, I hope nobody came to get anybody today. But if you come to church to get something, 9 times out of 10, you're going to get something. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the merciful, for they will what? For they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. The purer your heart is, the better you see God. That's pure and simple. The purer your heart is, the better you see God. The cleaner my heart is, the better I am going to, the more I'm going to be able to see God. Why? Because I don't have all junk in my heart. I don't have all the junk in my heart. It's the junk in the heart that makes it so difficult to see. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. I wonder what the fussers and fighters are going to be called. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness. Blessed are those who are persecuted for doing the very best they know how to do. Blessed are those who are persecuted because they tried to stand up for righteousness and justice and they still get shot down. For theirs is the kingdom of God. Now, there's a whole bunch there, and we could spend a whole bunch of time there, but we're not. But I'm going to tell you that word blessed that I just read, or blessed, however you want to say it, blessed or blessed, you know what that word means? That means happy. So it means you're a happy person if you know that you're hungry, because why? There's a God out there that'll fill you. Happy are you if you go around spreading peace, because what? You're going to find yourself in a world of peace. You want to know why so many people are upset and in a world of fussing and fighting? Want me to give you the real revelation out of the Word of God? You know why folks fussing and fighting never have peace? Because they're always fussing and fighting. You're not going to have a lot of happiness in your life and a lot of happiness in your home and a lot of happiness at school and a lot of happiness at work and a lot of happiness everywhere if you go around biting everybody's head off. He said, well, they bit my head off too. Well, you know what? You get your head bit off all the time. I mean, seriously, the only way that's never going to happen, the only way that'll never happen is if you stay in your little bed and never leave your little bed. Then you have a chance that no one's going to bite your head off unless you're sharing your bed with somebody else. This is the way of the world. He said, blessed are the peacemakers, blessed are the merciful, for they will see happy. There's a whole list of things that Jesus said will make you happy. Now, there's Jesus' list of happy. Let me show you a real good description real quickly of what it means to be unhappy. You want to get this real quick? Look in Romans 7. Romans 7, look in verse 15. Verse 15, Romans 7. Everybody there? I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want to do, but I do the very thing that I hate. He says, I do not do what it is that I want to do, but I do the very thing that I hate. Why do you do the thing that you hate, or don't do the thing that you want to do? Why? You know what he says later on? He said it's because your mind isn't right. Thoughts become actions. Actions become a life. He says, I do what it is that I don't want to do, and I don't do what it is that I want to do. Why? Right up here. Keep on reading. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good, but in fact it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells in me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is in my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. Why? Right up here, your mind. Go on to Romans 8, right here. If I don't do what it is that I know I'm supposed to do, or if I do what it is that I know I'm not supposed to do, right up here. Because My thoughts will give birth to actions, and my actions will give birth to life. If I think good thoughts, I'm going to do good things. If I think bad thoughts, I'm going to do bad things. If I think getting even thoughts, then I'm going to spend my life trying to get even. If I think peaceful thoughts, I'm going to have a peaceful life. Starts right up here. Starts right in your mind. So Jesus said, happy are what? He gave you a whole list of things. Happy are you if this or that. And then here's your unhappy right here. Because you know your life needs to be a certain way and you can't turn it into that. I can't do it. Now look in Romans 8. And this is what we're going to read that we got up there too. Romans 8. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. See that? There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And then look in verse 9. It's not up there, but look in verse 9. Verse 9. You are not in the flesh, but you are in the Spirit, since the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. No condemnation. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ is none of his. Verse 14. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. Got it? No condemnation. Those who have not the Spirit of Christ are none of his. All who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. And then Romans 8:28. All things work together for good. For those who love God, for those who are called according to his purpose. Here's the message right here. I know I've told you about the guy that I heard of who ripped this page out of his Bible that had Romans 8:28, that all things work together. He took his Bible and he ripped this page out of his Bible. All things work together for good. For those who love God, for those who are called according to his purpose. He said, it's not true. Life stinks. I don't believe there's a God. It's all junk. Bam. He ripped it out of his page. And I can appreciate that because of the way life is. But I was thinking on this verse, Romans 8:28, which is what we just ended with. And I got a little insight as to how you could paraphrase this to make sense of it all. We say all things work together for good for those who love God and those who are called according to his purpose. And this is the thought I had. For those who do the very best they know to do, day after day, week after week, month after month, for those who do the very best they know to do, for those who do that, they have the assurance that God is working with them and in them and through them every step of the way. For those who do the will of God, but it's a trick because to know the will of God, you have to know the Word and you have to know the voice of God. And in order to know the voice of God, in order to know the Word of God, you've got to what? You've got to have a new mind. There are two steps to being a happy person. Two steps, I am convinced. Money won't do it. Relationships won't do it. Prestige won't do it. Power won't do it. I don't care how much power you get. Power will not do it. There are only two steps to being a happy person. And the first is this. You and I have to receive a different spirit. It doesn't mean showing up to church. It doesn't mean having a perfect attendance record. It doesn't mean knowing the Bible cover. You can have all of that and still have not received a new spirit. Step one is to receive a new spirit, and that's the trick, receiving. Because there are people in this life who will refuse to receive anything from God and who will refuse to receive anything from anybody else because we have believed the myth of the self-made man. Self-made man. I am where I am because I put myself here, to which the parable comes back. If you see a turtle on a fence post, you know that he did not get there by himself. No one gets anywhere in life economically, personally, spiritually. No one gets anywhere in life unless they have some help. No one does. If you find someone living a good and happy life, they are living a good and happy life because they had some help. Condemnation. That is the root of what it means for so many people to be alive in this world, living a life of condemnation. And if you want it in plain, simple English, condemnation is the thought in my head that said, I'm not right, I stink, nothing else is ever going to be right. Nothing is right, I'm not right. Condemnation. You don't like yourself, you're never going to like yourself, and for a lot of us, it's because of the way we were raised. Did you know that there are children in this world who grow up hearing nothing but you are low down, no good, and you are never going to be anything? There are voices of condemnation in this world every single day. You don't even have to leave your house. You can turn on Facebook. If you can turn on Facebook, you can turn on your TV, and you can hear condemnation day after day, minute after minute. But he says there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. To be in Christ Jesus means to be in a different spirit. And you said, what does it mean to be in the spirit of Jesus? I'm glad you asked. Because if you will take 1 Corinthians 13 and put Jesus' name in front of each description, love is patient, love is kind, love is not easily angered, love bears, believes, hopes. Put Jesus' name in front of each one of those. Jesus is patient, Jesus is kind, Jesus is not easily angered. The Spirit of Jesus. And then put your little name, or put my little name in front of that. And then see if I impart. See, there's the thing. Every verse in the Bible brings us what? Straight face to face with the fact that I'm not what it is that I need to be. Seriously. If you can read 1 Corinthians 13 and say, well, I'm a good, upstanding Christian, then you hadn't read 1 Corinthians 13 the right way. You hear what I'm saying? That is a sweet chapter. It is one of my very favorite parts in the whole Bible. But if you can read the words of 1 Corinthians 13 about being patient, about being kind, about being forgiving, about being merciful, that's what it means to be in Christ. That's what it means to be in a different spirit. And to get that spirit, you've got to receive it. You've got to receive it. And stepping in the doors of a building or any of these things that we think, or studying my Sunday school lesson, as good a thing as that is, none of it is a replacement for what? Receiving a different spirit. There are church people that are walking around thinking that they're walking in the spirit of Christ, and all they're doing is spreading the spirit of the devil everywhere they go. Okay, I got to say that again. Mom, I said something one Sunday, and Mom said, you should have said that two or three more times. I'm going to say it again. There are people that are walking around calling themselves Christians. They got their name on a roll, and all they do day after day is spread the spirit of the devil wherever they go. You don't have to open your mouth. You can just type it. You can spread the spirit of hatred. You can spread the spirit of animosity. You can spread the spirit of all of this junk instead of receiving a different spirit. John Wesley, the man that started the Methodist Church, was coming back from America, a failed missionary, and they got caught in the storm on a boat. And there were some Moravian Christians on the boat that prayed and sang and went through that whole thing like nothing was happening. When he landed, he said, they got something that I need. And it wasn't long after that he felt his heart strangely warmed. A Christian, grown-up Christian preacher and missionary who felt his heart strangely warmed. And he said, I finally felt in my own heart that God loved even me. Loved even me, to receive a different spirit. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Did you catch it? He said, if you have the Spirit of Christ, you're his. But if you have not the Spirit of Christ, the Spirit of love, the Spirit of patience, the Spirit of forgiveness and forbearance, the Spirit of goodwill towards men, then you're none of his. So to receive a different spirit, I can tell you what, you can walk a church aisle, you can say a few words, and you can go back and you can be the same person you were. You can go under the water a million times, you can still get up dirty every single time. You have got, and I have got to get to the point where I can say, like the great Methodist preacher said, I really do stink, and he said it stronger than that. I really do stink. I need a new start. And it's a mystery how it happens. It can happen loudly or it can happen quietly. When it happened for me, it was like the perfect storm and everything got turned upside down, got turned right side up. For some people, it's as quiet as anything could be, just like a gentle rainstorm. And yet the ground still gets soaked, no matter how strong the rain is. You got to get a different spirit. And that's the promise that you read all through the Hebrew Bible, all through the New Testament. I will put a new spirit in you. I will put a new heart in you. Because the old heart is what? What were the Ten Commandments made of? Stone. Ten Commandments made of stone. And he said, I will put a new heart in you, so your heart is not made of stone, but your heart is soft and willing to receive and willing to do what it is that God wants you to do. So to receive a different spirit, but not just to receive it, then to what? To work it out. I'm not doing God any good, and I'm not doing the world any good, and I'm not doing my neighbor any good to say that I have received the Spirit of Christ and I'm not working it out on a regular basis in my own life. The title of this message, just to remind you in case you forgot, is How to Have a Happy Life. When you work out this new spirit that you receive, that's when you begin to see a difference. Jesus said it this way. He said, happy are those who hear the word of God. Happy are those who hear the word of God and who do it. You said, I don't know the will of God. Yes, you do. Don't sit there and tell that. I'm not staring at anybody because someone's going to say I'm not staring at anybody right now. Don't sit there and tell that story, because this is where most of us faint. It's easy to walk a church aisle. It is, trust me, it is easy to walk a church aisle. It's much tougher when I know exactly what it is that I need to do and I refuse to do it. That's when you begin to stop growing. And that's what kills the Spirit of Christ in the human life. The organ, I read it this week, the organ of spiritual insight is obedience. In the same way that I open my eyes and see color, I see the kingdom of God when I obey. When I do what it is that I know God wants me to do, that in that moment is when I encounter the kingdom of God. So don't sit there and tell that story that you don't know what God wants you to do. 9 times out of 10, what God wants me to do is what I'm not sure I can do or what I'm sure I don't want to do, and yet I know that I need to do it anyway. And you dig in your heels, like the woman who said, I will die and go to hell before I forgive. True story. I will die and go to you know where before I forgive. You say people in church don't feel that way. You won't make a bet? I don't bet. I don't work too hard for the money to make a bet. When you and I do what it is that we know God wants us to do. You want a Bible example? Abraham went because he didn't know, even though he didn't know where he was going. God called him. Genesis 12. Abraham went because God said, I want you to leave home. Does that mean I need to leave home to do the will of God? No, it doesn't. But it means sometimes I got to do things that my family won't understand and my friends won't understand. It means I don't need to go and make a relationship right. It means I need to go and make this right or that right, working out what it is that God has put in. I'll put it to you in plainer language than this. Trust and obey, because there's no other way to be happy than to trust and obey. I hope some of y'all listen, because it's not because I'm a hot shot, but I'm telling you, there's some pearls right here. To do the will of God, not in any abstract fashion, but very specifically. If God tells you to end it, you need to end it. If God tells you you need to start it, you need to start it. If God tells you you need to get it straight, you need to get it straight. And it doesn't usually change overnight. When I was in the Mediterranean, the one time I went to the Mediterranean, that's in Europe, we were on a boat, and I got on deck at about 4 or 5 in the morning before the sun had come up and it was overcast clouds. And I sat there for hours, and the strangest thing happened. The more I sat there, the lighter it became. And all of a sudden, it was dawn. Never saw the sun, never saw it come up. But it was a new day. For those of us who are able to say, Washington, D.C. won't give it to me. Almighty dollar won't give it to me. Flesh and blood will not give it to me. But God Almighty can give me a new spirit. For those who receive and work it out, there is happiness not just to come, but happiness in this life. I have lived now for half a century. And one thing I have learned is this. The happy people in the world are the people that are able to say, when the day starts, dear God, show me what to do with this day. You got it. It was worth coming to church to hear that right there. You wake up in the morning and you say, dear God, what do you want me to do with this day? No condemnation for those who walk after the Spirit. And for those who do the very best that they can, God working with us and in us and through us. Blessed are those who hear and do the Word of God. Blessed are they. You want to have a happy life? Get a new spirit and work it out. In Jesus' name, let's pray. God, we thank you for the word, for the spirit, and for truth that sneaks out and grabs us. in this crazy, beautiful world. Help us who call ourselves followers of Jesus to be of a different mind, a different spirit, a different attitude. May our mind, may our attitude be the same as Christ Jesus, who gave it all. Freely we have received, dear God. May we freely give. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
189. Stand.
Step away.